Tim Geyer, and just to clarify right off the top, Michael's a football player, I'm the TV guy. I know there was some confusion about that, but now we got that straight. We thought we'd do something a little bit different then. Michael's a professional athlete, used to being interviewed after games, so we thought we would do this almost in an interview setting. And I'll ask him some questions, and he will pretty much answer to the crowd and then go on that. But then at the end, we'll also upward it up to the Q&A and all that. And Michael just told me before that he has been, this is his second tour of I Beat the Odds. This is the paperback that came out last week.
Right.
And this is his last stop on this tour, so we are on.
Best of
last. Best of last. And now, why don't we start right there and just tell everybody there's a very, very special message in I Beat the Odds. Why don't you tell people kind of what the book is and what the message is?
Like I said before, just reaching back, I really didn't want to do, you know, this book right there, and because, you know, blindside people, I thought it would be overkill, and you know, a lot of people thought that, you know, knew my story, and you know, I started to get so many letters from people really across the world telling me how I inspired them and how I changed their lives, and you know, I said, you know, they really wanted, they said, tell me in your own words, and I said, no, I don't want to do it, then. You know, as I started to read these letters, and you know, as I'm doing these book signings, you know, the people that come up to me with, they introduce me to their kid and they said, you know, we adopted this kid because of you, we learned your story. And, you know, just to keep inspiring people and keep giving people hope. So, you know, that's one of the main reasons. And, you know, it's really going back, you know, to my younger years before the blind side. So, just showing people that from the time I was 7 years old, I always had a strong inner drive to succeed and, you know, be something in life. And I feel that I was already successful. You know, I didn't want to, you know, get caught up in, you know, that cycle of growing up, dropping out of school, getting involved in the games, the drugs, and the violence. So, you know, I was already, you know, a level-headed kid, and I always thought I was, you know, an intelligent kid. And my mom didn't teach me how to play football. I always understood the game of football.
Well, everybody, of course, knows the story of the Blind Side, right? That's that movie.
Yeah.
And let's talk a little bit about that, and just how closely does that reflect just everything that you came through and the story of your life?
It hits on, like I said, the football part. I think I've always thought of, you know, myself as a bright, you know, kid, intelligent kid, and you know, but it hit on a lot of the basic things, and you know, for, you know, me and, you know, my mom, for them to take me in, coming from where I came from, and knowing that the things that, you know, goes on in my neighborhood, and for them to take me in, I don't know if I would have took somebody in from my neighborhood. And, you know, it was a struggle for them. And, you know, I had to survive and, you know, had to, you know, do a lot of things on my own from the time I was 7 years old. Just being a kid, you know, I look at your son, he's not much older than I was. And I was.
You're a little bigger.
I was probably a little bigger. All over town, just trying to survive, just trying to find food, and that's how hard it was a lot of the time. And like I said, for them to take me in and invite me in their home, it was truly a blessing, because, you know, I didn't know what was growing up. I didn't know what was on the other side of the tracks. You know, I knew that I was going to get there, you know, no matter what. And you know, for me to have that opportunity was a blessing.
And for you to have overcome all those odds, I mean, to have come out of poverty, at times homelessness, to overcome academic challenges, to go through and get a college education, play Division I ball, you must have felt like you succeeded before you even got to the NFL.
Exactly. The NFL is really a bonus. Number one thing that I'm most proud of is going through everything. When I got into the school, I graduated from a private school. When I got in there, I had a .8 GPA. That was going into .8 GPA my sophomore year. I didn't have the, you know, the opportunity that everybody that averaged a 3.0 GPA. I mean, everybody was extremely smart. And I was the last guy in the class, ranking in class academic-wise, and you know, I'm very competitive. And I was embarrassed. And you know, by my senior year, I needed like a 3.5 GPA to get into college. And GPA coming in. And so my last semester, I averaged a 3.6 GPA, and I had passed a couple of people on the class rankings. Just kept my head on straight and stayed around away from the wrong people and, you know, just focus.
Well, everybody wants to know, is there really that video of you blocking that guy down the field on the fence?
Well, we don't block like that.
As I said, he's the guy.
That was a long time ago. I didn't, I blocked him to his sideline, and, you know, it was his teammates was over there, so as we got over there, I was, you know, trying to take him wherever, but, you know, like 80 people jumped on my back. Yeah, I did take them, you know, half of it.
And then there really was that stream of college coaches and letters. And what was that process like, just being recruited so heavily?
It was a great process because I just to see those major, I was a Tennessee Volunteer fan growing up, and just to see all the big, all those colleges coming. When I was, like I said, when I was 13, I said, as long as I can get into any college, it could have been small college, anything, just to see all those major colleges come through, it was unbelievable because I didn't really have a chance because I didn't play my sophomore year, and in my ninth grade year I was at another school, so my junior year I was playing different positions, and just to see all those, I got recruited really fast, and because I was on the map for 1 year, and it was a fast process for me, but I had a blast and, you know, really enjoyed it.
Well, this is big.
I didn't get as many letters from Georgia though. So.
Oh.
We lost them both of those guys, but you know, they were great players.
Yeah, that still doesn't excuse not sending a letter. But how, I guess, is the NFL different than college? Everybody likes to think you play college football for the love of the game, you play the NFL because it's your job. But how are the games themselves?
Well, it's a big difference. Like you say, it is your job now. It's a business, so it's a lot of fun. It's something that I dreamed about growing up. I had some the dreams that I had growing up, the really dreams I had with me getting drafted into the NFL, playing in the NFL. And every day that I go to work and on Sundays, it's a dream come true. And I have to pinch myself every day, and I'll never get used to it.
And it doesn't end. You just said you're going to start working out again Monday.
It's a year-round season. You can't take 2 minute day off. I already took 2 minute days off by, you know, coming with two guys. You know, it's a year-round league. You have to, you know, get right back to it.
All right. Well, let's go back a little bit and talk about your experience in foster care before the Blind Side and all that. Just tell folks about that.
I think foster care, you know, it was important for me. I think it, you know, helped me. You know, understand that, you know, before I got taken in, I would be outside all times of the night and didn't have a set time to go to bed and things like that. When I got to foster care, you know, I went to school. I had to go to school every day. I had to, you know, be asleep at a certain time. And, you know, it helped me, you know, understand that, you know, life is not, you know, it's more serious than I thought it was. And, you know, as I got older, still no one was telling me to go to school or anything like that, so I did everything on my own. I went to school on my own. I caught buses on my own, and I think being in foster care, that helped me, you know, want to, you know, continue to, you know, the progress of, you know, becoming who I am today.
Well, you got structure there, and you learned some self-responsibility.
Right.
How did you rely on those two qualities to write a book?
Man, this book, I didn't, my senior year in high school, I had the toughest English teacher around. And that was my worst class. I hated going there every day. And I know she is shocked that I have a bestseller. We thought she was a bounty hunter at the time. Back then.